Professor Ishtiaq Ahmed is Professor Emeritus at Stockholm University. Presently, he is also teaching at Government College University, Lahore. Author of several books, including the award-winning Punjab Bloodied, Partitioned, and Cleansed. Next, I would request Leyludin Ali. Dr. Leyludin. She is curator at British Library here and here in London, and she has researched on the left movement in Bengal. I would now request my colleague and friend James Karen. He is here at SOAS and was, you know, self-introduced almost half an hour ago, so all of you would remember. First, let me acknowledge that there is a slight change in this program, unlike what we had advertised, because one of our panelists, Dr. Khalid, got sick, he couldn't attend today. In this session, all the speakers will have roughly 20 minutes for the talk, and the session will be followed as usual by a Q&A session. We hope to finish by like 8:30. It will be followed by a coffee break, so some relaxation. Bear with us. But I'm sure the talks will keep you glued to this session. First of all, I would request Dr. Ishtiaq. He will begin the panel discussion. It will be followed by Leyli, and it will end with James' paper, actually. Dr. Ishtiaq will speak about his work on the partition of Punjab. And as Asim has already pointed out, James has pointed out, this year also marks the 70th anniversary of the bloody partition, the traumatic experience which still shapes our politics in the Indian subcontinent, our polities, and perhaps so many different ideologies there. Over to you, Dr. Ishtiaq.
Please. Let me begin by saying with very deep feelings that I'm greatly honored to be invited to come and speak here. Although I must also say that there is an incongruence in the conference today, because on the one hand we have Bhagat Singh, a great personality of India and who needed a keynote speaker to tell us about his great qualities. And then we have the whole trauma of the partition reduced to 20 minutes for each speaker, which I think is a bit unfair, if I may say. Anyhow, I'll connect this to my old friend and comrade Pritam Singh by saying that if Bhagat Singh were to come back and say what would he regret the most, I think it would be the partition of India. Because he was an internationalist, and as fortunately Pritham in the end told us that he wrote Why I'm an Atheist, I think he abjured all religious connections and became a great, great human being. And the partition of India, the partition of Punjab, the partition of Bengal is the ultimate defeat of all that is humane and all that is good in human beings. I have written this book, The Punjab Bloodied, Partitioned, and Cleansed. And people read it as a book of history. Actually, that's not a fair way of approaching my book, because I'm a political scientist. And for me, the very title, The Punjab Bloodied, Partitioned, and Cleansed, are three stages in a process. The first stage is when, in March 1947, for a few weeks, the whole of Punjab, the four or five major cities of Punjab were drenched in blood. Then comes Mountbatten and he starts the negotiations. And that consummates with him declaring on the 3rd of June 1947 that India will be partitioned and that Punjab and Bengal will have a right through their assemblies to decide whether they want the whole province to go to India or to Pakistan. And then the power is transferred to the governments of India and the Indian Punjab, East Punjab and the Pakistani West Punjab, just to indicate the changes which were happening during this period from 1947 January to about the middle of August. According to Sir Evan Jenkins, the Punjab governor, only 5,200 people had been killed. For every Muslim killed, six Sikh or Hindus were killed. So that was the proportion. Okay. And then from the middle of August until the 31st of December, anywhere between 500,000 to 800,000 Hindus, Muslims and Sikhs were killed. 90,000 women were abducted, many of them raped, some returned, many rejected by their families, children raised on spears. It was the worst demonstration of the loss of humankind by Hindus, Muslims and Sikhs. But in the 20 minutes, I'll try to contextualize it. Ultimately, the decision to partition India was not that of Jinnah or of Congress, as is very often alleged. It was that of the British, because they had come to this conclusion that, and I, although I think today when I listened to Pritham, I was reassured. His understanding of Nehru is not all that hostile as I had imagined, and that's very good. Because if you look at the documents, I have quoted documents, actual documents of the British military, they say that Mr. Jinnah would like to be a member of the Commonwealth, and we should ask Pakistan to give access to the Karachi port facilities, to the Pakistan airfields, and Muslim manpower. Muslim manpower actually means the Pakistan army. Because the British actually were not thinking of letting go of India. This is a myth. I've gone through some stuff now, and till 1977, they had very good plans of staying on to India. It's the Second World War which actually destroyed their ability to hold on to empire, and it was the American pressure which forced them to leave. Which is not to deny the great movement for freedom which Congress led, and I don't want to belittle the Congress. Born a Pakistani and a Muslim and in a family which believed that the partition was ultimately good, my conclusion is that it has been the worst type of outcome of a conflict in which at least three parties should always be counted. The Indian National Congress, the All India Muslim League, but most certainly the British. It's very easy to run down Jinnah by quoting documents where he can be pinned down for saying things which are not all that conducive to peace and so on. And similarly, even Nehru can be found making such remarks here and there, and Gandhi, of course, is a controversial figure, although of the three, I think Gandhi had the right vision. He had foreseen that if there is a partition, it would be bloody and it will result in, you know, great suffering to the people. So I would equip Gandhi on this on many accounts. But coming to the partition of India, the partition of Punjab, let me present the basic argument. It is like this. If there was no partition of India, there would be no partition of the Punjab. But from this, it does not follow that if India were partitioned, so must the Punjab. So ultimately, we have to go into the politics, the historical legacy, in which, you know, an historical legacy, as Pritham would tell you, is very easy to manipulate. You know, it's even among two friends, you may live all your life as great friends, And then when you break up, you just remember the bad things they did. And this happens also very easily when politicians exaggerate, manipulate the differences which did exist, no doubt. There was the horrible caste system, but there was also fanatical Islam all the time there. And the Sikhs were second to none in their own sort of extremism. So all these tendencies were there. And yet, by and large, the wisdom of the Punjab was to live and let live. You know, if you look at the 1,000 years of Sufi, contribution to the yogi, to the Gorakhnathi yogis, to the Bhakti movement, and then, of course, the four Sikh gurus who were men of peace. And were it not for the Mughal Empire, which started persecuting the later gurus, there would be another brotherhood among many others in the Punjab. So we have a rich, rich tradition of a wisdom of the people rooted in the soil that, okay, we are different, but we can always live together with our differences. But with the modern sort of state coming up and modern education coming up, so did revivalism, Hindu revivalism, Islamic revivalism, and Sikh revivalism. And when revivalism comes in, you know, the ambiguities which exist in popular culture, they disappear. And instead, you have orthodox versions of Hinduism, Islam, and Sikhism coming up. And that's just the right moment to preach communal politics. So Punjab succumbed to this sort of extremist politics only when the leadership in the Punjab of the three communities could not agree on how to keep the province united. In 1940, the All India Muslim League demands separate states for Muslims in Lahore. 2 weeks later, the Sikh leaders say that we want a united India, but if India is divided on the basis of religion, we will demand the partition of the Punjab on a similar basis, so that those areas which are predominantly Hindu-Sikh majority districts would be given to India or to a Sikh state. And this continues, as we know. You know, you can't look at the partition of the Punjab without relating it to the all, you know, to the colonial level, the government in the UK, the Viceroy in India, and then the Punjab administration. And from there, then you can go and relate it to the events which took place in the villages and cities of Lahore. So basically, it was the decision to partition India which ignited the riots in the Punjab. And why did... Now, just to... Let me...
10 more minutes.
Yeah. Let me try to show you the contrast. In the whole of India, there were 380 million souls. The estimate is that anywhere between 1 and 1.5 million people were killed. Okay? 14 to 15 million people had to run for their lives across the Red Cliff line drawn in 1947. Now, just compare this with the population of the Punjab at that time. 33.9 million, if you include the princely states. And if you don't include the princely states, 28 million. So it's a very small population. But at the end of the day, anywhere between 500,000 to 800,000 Punjabis were killed. Now that's about 80% of all fatalities which took place in the partition as a whole took place in the Punjab. 10 million Punjabis had to run, literally run for their lives, out of a population of 33 million. That's 30% of the population. And may I emphasize this very strongly, this was the first case of ethnic cleansing after the Second World War. Some people may prefer to call it religious cleansing, which is also fine. For a historian, that religious cleansing makes more sense, but for a political scientist, since we are looking at general categories, this is a form of ethnic confrontation. So it was the Punjab which bore the brunt of the partition horrors. Why? Is there something intrinsically wrong with the Punjabi Muslims or Hindus and Sikhs? Well, some would argue yes. That's not the point. I think you have to bring into the picture the fact that during the Second World War and the First World War, the people who served in the Indian British Army were, by and large, half the army was Punjabis. And in 1945, then, when they were demobilized, many had come back carrying with them their guns, with grenades, you know, and above all, the training to kill, spending 4 years in the trenches. I'm sure half of them were already psychopaths. You know, killing people is not very difficult when you serve and you just shoot just to save your life. So it was these people I have shown in my book who were recruited by a nexus of politicians, local criminal gangs, and lower sections of the administration, magistrates, thanedars, and so on and so forth. And because of this sort of constellation of, you know, armed people trained to kill, once the state could not maintain its law and order, and that was the British state, it was passed on to two partisan administrations on the Indian side, an Indian administration, and on the Pakistani side, a Pakistani administration. Tacitly, it was agreed that you have to get rid of the minorities. And that's what happened. You know, within a period of less than 5 months, of the 6 million Muslims of East Punjab, hardly any survived, except a few in this tiny state of Malerkotla, and that's thanks to Guru Gobind Singh's, his blessings. Except for this particular role of this blessing of Guru Gobind Singh for the Nawab of Malerkotla, that in any future conflict with Muslims, the Muslims of this state were not to be touched, there would have been no Muslim surviving in East Punjab. Similarly, on our side, we had 4.5 million Hindus. By 31st December 1947, hardly anybody ever saw a Sikh again. I grew up, and the first time I ever saw a Sikh was when the Yatris started coming again. This was sometimes in the 50s, mid-50s. And really no Hindus either, although they look like any Muslim because of the same sort of appearance. So you can well imagine that the partition of the Punjab is the ultimate bearer of the guilt of the leaders of British colonialism, and it represents the debasement of humanity at its worst. I think I would rather conclude here. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay,
so over to you, Leyli.
Right. Okay, I'd like to start off with a quick thanks to the organizers for inviting me here. I should state that my qualifications to speak here is not really as a curator for the British Library, but the fact that I'm a social and intellectual historian who looks at the making and unmaking of East Pakistan, in particular the political mobilization of peasants and workers and their relationship to the charismatic figure of Maulana Bashani. Now, I'm going to make two apologies first, and the first being that I have not really strictly followed the brief. The other is that the paper, there's a patchy incoherence to the paper. On the one hand, it's trying to share sort of information on a subject that I'm assuming most people don't know about, but on the other hand, it's trying to do what good historians try to do, which is to shape or think about shaping better imaginings, ideas, and space for future action. Now, It's a poignant day to be speaking here on the subject of radicals, revolutionary imaginings and resistance, because today marks the 46th anniversary of a 9-month-long war between the people of East Bengal and the state of Pakistan, in which people fought for, once again, the futures that had been denied to them, the futures of freedom, dignity and equality. But let me move from 71 to 1947. The year 1947, as we know, wasn't experienced in the same way by everyone, everywhere in the subcontinent. It was not just a story about partition, violence and trauma, but also a moment pregnant with the hopes, dreams and aspirations of freedom. And this was in some sense very much the case for East Bengal. It was Bengali Muslims that moved Lahore Resolution, who had thrown their weight behind the demand of Pakistan and voted for this in the select referendum. And I want to talk about these hopes, dreams, aspirations of freedom, but by not going back into the pre-partition era, but by looking at how they continue to reveal themselves after 47. And in doing so, I'll tell a different story, not of students, middle class, and the intelligentsia, who have often been thought of the revolutionary subjects, but of peasants, workers, and the heroes that they have elected for themselves. And these are groups that have often been seen as spectators, but as never as agents of their own liberation. So following on from Bhagat Singh, I think it's only appropriate to offer another revolutionary figure on this platform, and that is Maulana Abdul Hamid Khan Bashani. And whilst I'll discuss him in his context, I also want to think about the question of why Bashani ought to be remembered today. Now I suspect that apart from a handful in the audience today, most are unfamiliar with Maulana Bashani. You know, I don't hold you responsible for that, but of course it does beg the question of who gets remembered and who doesn't in our histories, and in what spaces, contexts, and audiences does it become urgent to recover those and remember those who have been forgotten. Bashani has been known as the Red Maulana. He was a Sufi, he lived from 1880 to 1976. He was a powerful Sufi peer, politician, peasant, and labor leader who acquired prominence in the region of East Bengal and beyond over the colonial and post-colonial period for a number of reasons, namely for his formidable skills in mass mobilization of subordinate constituencies against the various regimes of Pakistan up to 1971 and then in Bangladesh, and the struggle to acquire dignity, justice and equality. The epithet Red Maulana was a result of his unlikely leadership of radical, left-leaning and progressive factions, especially the National Army of Pakistan. Bashani was a man, however, pilloried by the establishments of his time. He was described as the prophet of violence, the Pakistani Ayatollah Bashani, fire-eater, rustic, illiterate and dangerous fool, Ghafir and Hanuman, largely because of his unceasing and unsparing attacks on those who held power for their various neglects and failures, for his creative and orthodox politics, which brought different life worlds, traditions and politics together, and for his relationship with subordinate constituencies. It is through Bashani we understand how misunderstood peasants and workers have been in the making and unmaking of East Pakistan and the making of Bangladesh. Thus far, the students, intelligentsia and urban dwelling population have occupied our sort of historiography. It is they who've been forefront of the popular struggles, assuming the more radical and progressive positions, such as during the 1969 movement against the Ayub regime. But actually we find that these constituencies were actually a more conservative and repressive force, repelling the more forceful mobilization coming from the rural countryside. Historian Tajul Islam Hashmi's description of peasants as God-fearing and awe-stricken by ravages and nature, debilitated by a tremendous inferiority complex, does not hold muster. Peasants and workers of this period were instead informed and active translators and interpreters of politics. They forged alliances and solidarities and chose their leaders as well as the struggles that they wished to engage in. The politics of peasants and workers was not one of pieties or advocating the return of a mythical pot, as often suggested by subordinate historians, but one that heralded Islam as a discourse and project of progress, modernity, and freedom. What I want to discuss today, though, is the discomfort that Maulana Bashani produced within his own constituencies. And this discomfort comes from his challenge of their complacency, their silence, and fear of freedom. I describe his politics as the fragments of the pedagogy of the oppressed. I'll outline what I believe are three elements in his pedagogy. Before I describe the elements of this pedagogy, I should attempt to answer what is the relevance of one which sprung under different historical, material, geographical conditions to us today, here in this room. Now, Bishani described oppression as a state of being omanush, of being non-human. If we can agree that oppression is an act of dehumanization, of being made to feel less human, especially by those in power, then we can suggest here in the UK today or elsewhere that the current treatment of the sick, the differently abled, working class family whose benefits are stripped from them, of workers who are forced to work long hours and low pay and 0-hour contracts, the harassment and detention of racial communities and Muslims by law enforcement and security services, and the hostile treatment of vulnerable migrants and refugees is nothing other than that of the act of making people feel less than human. So under these circumstances, a pedagogy of the oppressed becomes important, if not imperative, a pedagogy that strives towards the humanization process. So the first element of Bashani's pedagogy was the legitimization of anger as a powerful and transformative political emotion. Bashani was dismissed by his opponents as an unprecedented rabble-rouser, or simply an agitator, even by those within his party. He explained his reasons for doing so, for why he was such an agitator. In the early 20th century, in colonial Bengal, Bashani led a campaign against the Maharaja of Santosh, north of Dhaka, against the oppressive rent rates and land seizures from poor peasants. When asked by the zamindar as to why Bashani was against him, Bashani said, you would not recognize me and treat me as an equal unless I agitate and create trouble for you. Anger for Bashani was one of the key signs of critical consciousness, people recognizing their omanush, their dehumanized state, by speaking it, by naming it, and thus taking the first steps towards recovering their humanity. In 1954, during the period of the first provincial elections in East Pakistan, at one of the election rallies in one of the small towns in North Bengal, a young Fazle Khuda, who was less awestruck by Bashani's belligerent speech, which was directed at Adarov, a member of law enforcement present. In his recollection, he stated, quote, "Our experience of them, the police was as jallads, devils. If they wanted, they could arrest anyone and beat them. We understood for the first time then that the police was there not to help us, not was there to help and not rule over us. They work for us." Bashani's irreverence, or rather his defiance of authority, was the attempt to restore power and authority to those who he believed were true sovereigns, the people. And why is this important? Today, the government silences and delegitimizes anger. And it's the anger of certain groups in particular, in our politics, conflating it with violence and extremism, repressing political protests and demonstrations, and by continuing to do so, making us feel less free and more oppressed. But this pedagogy was not built on anger alone. He regarded dialogue as integral towards working towards freedom and humanization. Dialogue signified a full embrace of the world and belonging to it. He brought workers and peasants into conversations from which they had been excluded by those in power. He did this in their spaces, using their own language, registers of understanding, and interpretive frameworks, festivals, boat tours to remote communities, and spiritual oaths, which were used to dialogue on issues of socialism, internationalism, and democracy. In 1957, when the Prime Minister of Pakistan, Sohrawardi, a member of Bashani's party, reaffirmed his commitment to bilateral and multilateral security agreements, CATO, the Baghdad Pact, reneging on the party's initial promises, securing the support of middle-class students and urban intelligentsia for these pacts, Maulana Bashani organized a village festival, a mela, as part of the party council convention to draw in the marginalized and destitute classes, and he used festival gates, music, art, and lectures to convey messages of friendship, cooperation and solidarity with the Afro-Asian bloc. For example, over 50 gates were set up, which those attending the festival passed by. Each of these gates had the names of various local, national, and international leaders emblazoned in them, like Mao, Abraham Lincoln, Gandhi, Subhas Bose, Rumi, Bernard Shaw, Jinnah, and the Prophet. And it was Jinnah who got the most number of brigades and not the Prophet. Now, there was no attempt made to separate individuals or endow ornamental hierarchical privilege on the basis of religion, nation, language, or geography. Rather, what was being asked of peasants and workers for whom most of the names, other than that of the Prophet, Jinnah, and a handful of others, were unfamiliar, was to reflect on the connections and unities between the different geographies, language, traditions, practices, and and ideas. So when Bishani spoke to the peasants and workers at the height of the unrest in the 1960s and described them as the Shorbahara, the proletariat, he did not define them by their lack, by their ubiquitous presence across different geographies, civilizations, and eras, possessing the power to change the course of history. The Shorbaharas for Bashani were the Bani Israelis in ancient Egypt, the Sicilian slaves who revolted against the Roman Empire, the Russian, European, Asian peasants and workers of the modern age working to establish an oppressiveless society. By inviting working class communities to reflect, speak and dialogue using familiar language, registers of understanding and framework, Bashani demonstrates that humanity was not an abstract or a complex concept, but one that was demonstrable and rooted. The third and most important element in Bashani's pedagogy was action. Action that built on reflection and sought to transform the situation of those oppressed. However, for Bashani, the endeavor or striving for full humanity was a collective one, achieved only through horizontal forms of solidarity and cooperation with others. It is thus in 1957 Bashani formed the National Awami Party in a united Pakistan, a coalition of left-leaning progressives, Marxists and religious followers, causing much alarm to the Pakistani state with its declared program of provincial autonomy, land reform, labor rights, industrialization, democratization, independent foreign policy and cooperation with the Afro-Asia bloc. Bashani was unconcerned with the epithet of Maulana that was given to him. In response to a question of whether he was a communist or Maulana by a journalist, Maulana Bashani replied, quote, "If you think that my life and thinking matches with that of a communist, then that is neither a matter of joy or sadness. If you too join hands with the enemies of equality, friendship, and freedom, then there is no escape from you, for you from my hands, none of you. However, if it fits with my ideas, and if anyone wants to take part in the struggle, I will take him delightedly into my embrace. Is the hunger only in the stomach of communists? Are they the only ones demanding medicines for the ill, homes for the homeless, and education for those deprived of education? Queen Elizabeth, stricken with hunger, will also want food. Will you call her a communist? If an innocent, naive child is hungry, he will cry, want food. But will you call the one who makes that demand for food a communist?" Anchored. In the 1960s, Bashani innovated with a spiritual oath that his religious followers signed up to. He added to their oath, beyond the usual articles of faith in God, the Prophet, and the Sufi peer itself, the pledge to establish socialism, to end imperialism, feudalism, and capitalism. The oath was to make a Marxist out of the disciple and the Marxist disciple, as he brought them into the mosques and the murids out into the world. The common purpose had not only made both groups acceptable to each other, but also endowed both with an equal standing of the right to enter into the same space and to participate in a shared language. The religious secular binary was not, Bashani demonstrated, an important or even a real impediment of striving towards humane and emancipatory politics of justice, dignity, and equality, or the humanization and liberation of people. To conclude, in electing a leader like Maulana Bashani, the peasants and workers have demonstrated not a disenchantment with freedom after 1947, but a continuing enchantment with it, and an acknowledgement of their role as the central architects of that future. It was an endorsement also of a pedagogy in which silence and fear of freedom was not an option. Reflection, speaking out, acting on your words, being creative and joining hands was critical. It probably explains then why it was not Azadi Jhooti Hai that was the slogan of that period in Eastern War that paid the rise. But it was the slogan, "Ekta kichu korte hobe," something has to be done, that was heard in Bengal. And perhaps it's a slogan for our times today as well, that something has to be done.
This is first time I'm chairing a panel where all these speakers will finish in stipulated time. Hope James follow the tradition. We'll have more time for the Q&A session. Okay, over to you, James.
All right. Thanks, Farooq. And thank you, Leyli. And Dr. Ahmed, this will be a hard act to follow. No, I really enjoyed that. Sorry. When you first start, so I'm going to talk about Khyber Pakhtunkhwa and what we might call communist and anarchist movements in it. And at the same time, I'm also going to talk about partitioning of space in an attempt to tie together some of the threads that we've seen so far. Anyway, so when you first start studying the history of Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, I mean, the primary narrative related to the anti-colonial resistance and liberation is that of Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan and the Khudaykhin Makar movement. This follows a number of the same tropes that Professor Singh mentioned in his beginning speech. In other words, this movement, starting in the early stages of organization before it took its actual shape in the 20s, and especially in the 1930s, was characterized by a nonviolent resistance and mass counter-organization against colonial power structures. Now, as part of this, I mean, the discourses that we see arising are Pashtun ethnic identity, but also reshaping what it means to be Pashtun away from an emphasis on individualistic values such as revenge and radical self-sovereignty into the equally Pashtun values of nonviolent resistance and mutuality and sort of radical egalitarianism. Now, this is the mainstream reading of the politics of that period. Why is this such a popular narrative? I mean, part of it is that our own narratives after the fact replicate colonial discourses about the ordinary state of the people of the frontier, which is to say their violence and their militancy and fanaticism, supposedly in each case. Another reason why it's a popular narrative, though, is because of Indian national discourse that folded the specificity of this movement and its local character into the story of the Indian National Congress. So when we see the narration of this period and these politics, I mean, we read like Gandhi importing his practice and ideas to the frontier with Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan, Bacha Khan, seen as a sort of protege of Gandhi's of sorts. And insofar as many narratives of South Asian history, and particularly activism of South Asia, from then until now, have overwhelmingly drawn from the self-told histories of the Congress and other organizations like it. I mean, this explains why we sort of replicate the dominant way of narrating the period. I'm going to talk about different things than that. And I'll do that soon. Now, when you start to look further at the histories of the time, and this requires reading Urdu and Pashto, typically, then you'll see a trajectory in the movement that itself mirrors the co-optation of the narrative to either Congress or post-colonial, neo-colonial readings of the history. In other words, what is the trajectory you see? I mean, you see non-elite unrest over inequalities channeled into a non-violent yet paramilitary organization. So in other words, rather unlike a legitimation of anger, it's a sublimation of anger. Unrest over inequalities channeled into a non-violent yet paramilitary organization. This was achieved through a series of discourses of comradeship, as well as through practices like bay'at in almost entirely the same form as Dr. Leyli Uddin talked about regarding Maulana Pashani's oaths, spiritual oaths. It also channeled a sort of subaltern affect into an organized, centralized mass and elite movement through body practices like the wearing of standardized uniforms and protesting in formation. These are all ways in which more plastic, inchoate senses of resistance and anger and egalitarianism and freedom were channeled into a particular hierarchical structure. In this, we have mass subjectivity not constituted as liberal subjects as such, right? Because you're submerging like your entire personhood into this movement. This is part of what the spiritual oaths said, you know? I put my thumbprint on this thing, recognizing that ultimate sovereignty is God's, the sovereignty below that is to the movement, and I, you know, submerge all of my sort of emotional world into the broader emotional world of the movement. So this is not at all a liberal conception of the subject. On the other hand, in an era of diarchy, so those of you who are familiar with South Asian history, right, after 1935, we had like a central legislature where the leaders of your regional movements would have to interact, and this was the sort of structure of sort of colonial and anti-colonial governance. In an era of diarchy, where mass movements on the provincial level were linked to elite parliamentary politics post-1935, the mass may not have been constituted as liberal subjects, but their parliamentarian leaders were. So here you get like a strong divorcing of this kind of self-abnegation of mass and the sort of fully formed self-sovereign subjects of these leaders who are tied in this movement to them. So my conclusion from looking at that and from looking at these sources, I mean, these movements were not exactly anti-hegemonic. They were counter-hegemonic, creating an alternate set of power relationships. These relationships cut out colonial power, but they also recolonized the mass in their own way into a mass itself. Also, the structures of the Khudeh-Khidmatgar organization were located in the same places that colonial infrastructure created, which is to say, market towns, railway colonies, with villages in their orbit, but not their own center of gravity. So, what we've got here is two things. One is a sort of counter-colonization of mass personnel, like personhood. On the other hand, we've got this counter-colonization in the same exact spatial locations as the actual colony. Now, why is that important? Well, in this case, this is a place that never had borders. When you read all the sources, any source that you can find, whether it's folklore or memoirs or anything, up until like 1922, there is no Pakhtun who didn't say that Pakhtun and Afghan is synonymous. Right, this was part of the same space. What was now in a side of Afghanistan and was over a formal, on the other side of a formal administrative boundary created by the British and the Afghan state. Nonetheless, this didn't have like any sense of reality to until much later. This wasn't an issue of drawing a line. This was an issue of pulling the infrastructure of states and pulling the infrastructure of leadership and circles of like gradually increasing hierarchy into spaces that reoriented Peshawar away from Kabul or from Bassi or whatever, and oriented it towards Delhi. Chop off Delhi, then it'll reorient it towards Karachi or Islamabad or whatever. In a place where there had never been borders, this creation of centers of gravity for resistance as well as for colonialization pulled agency away from the interregional mobility that had long characterized Pakhtun society, like since its beginnings, which we don't even know what they are, and partitioned space into a colonial sphere that was underlined rather than undermined when Pakistan became independent. So what I'm talking about here is all the different partitions that creations of hierarchy and the organizations of people into leaders and mass were made. We've got one partition with Punjab. We've got like repeated partitions with Bengal. We also have this partition of this space away from neither a sort of alternate state, but just from horizontal fluid space. Right. Now, in defense of the movement, the Hudayk al-Masar movement, of course one needs constraint before one begins resisting anything. This is what Sabah Mahmoud calls a paradox of subjectivation. Like, you need constraint as a mooring from against which you define your own radically different trajectory. At the same time, as we see, one still uses the raw materials of this constraint. You are bound to it, will never be otherwise. Sabah Mahmoud says this, so does the poet Hafiz from like 700 years before. And it's like, man is on ruski dad banded, I would never be free until I'm trapped in the trap of you. I can't free myself if I'm not trapped in something first. However, so one uses the raw materials of one's constraint, but one does not have to reformulate them into a replica of the colonial state. Now that's what I'm going to talk about for the rest of this. So as I started reading Pashto sources, and these include like memoirs and lots of poems and stuff, I started getting a new set of actors into my mind. Ones in which the subjecthood of mass and leaders were more of a two-way street, and here the parallel is quite a bit more like Maulana Pashani than it might be for other leaders of the anti-colonial movement. So, sources include memoirs like Dr. Waris Khan, a doctor in a village in Nosheira district, as well as Ajmal Khatak, who many of you might be more familiar with, a member of the National Awami Party, started by Maulana Pashani. So what we're talking about are not like comparative histories. This is part of one history of sort of subaltern, interregional leftist politics that do not fit the metropolitan leftist model. I'll show you how in a second, even if, although I think Leyli has done an excellent job of also showing how. Anyhow, so I start reading these memoirs, and it's like one of the actors who pops up again and again is this Maulana Abdurrahim Bulbulzi, the primary peasant organizer. He organized Dalit conferences, he organized peasant conferences, strikes against landlords, against the rule of, what was that called? Local custom? In levy. No, no. You know, when landlords put cesses on like taxes, like you make up your own arbitrary taxes on peasants, you know, big art and stuff like that. Anyhow, so he led up, the point being, here you've got Maulana Bulbulzi, the primary peasant organizer, the primary sort of urban subaltern organizer as well in the entire province. And the man was a Leninist. The man was also a Deobandi graduate and extraordinarily committed to both Sharia and Tariqa, so the guy was also a peer. And in fact, he traces the impulse for like why he became an activist to the idea of Wahdatul Wujud, the Sufi idea, which is to say everything's linked, I'm part of everything, I can't move without creating effects in anywhere. So if I'm gonna do that, then I'm going to do that knowingly and consciously. I'm going to protect the earth and I'm going to protect the people on it. Like that. Even more interesting is the Ajisip of Thurengzi, Haji Sahab of Thurengzi, who also was a Deobandi peer. He raised violent resistance through colonialism, basically starting in the 20s and on into the 40s from the tribal areas. In this one, we see a similar merging of his devotees, his murids, subjectivity, like their entire sense of self, into the sense of self of the Haji Sahab. At the same time, we see a similar recognition on the part of the Haji Sahib that actually he is nothing but the sum total of his devotees. And so he's more like a junction than a man, you know? He's like a sort of inhabiting all of the possible perspectives that his murids make possible. So here we have pedagogy as a two-way street. Right? You've got the peer instructing everybody in anti-colonial resistance. You also have the peer learning from and actually inhabiting, sort of ingesting the selfhood of his murids, legitimating their anger, and even sort of making it a part of himself and everything that he did. Devotees knew this. We know that from poems. So did Haji Sahib. we know this one belongs to. There were yet others. Let's see, Kapyaji Sanobar Hussain, one of the most interesting poets into the post-colonial period, himself also a communist, and as well as another Diobandi graduate. The man wrote lots of things. He was an internationalist. He was working with modernists in Egypt, and he wrote like works about one of the Prophet's companions, who he considered to be the first model for present-day communists. Fazlul Mahmud Makhfi, who I wrote about in the paper that I'm recycling a sizable component of for this. Fazlul Mahmud Makhfi, and yet another Diobandi graduate, working with Indian National Congress and other secret society members to bring down British colonialism, not just in South Asia, but wherever it worked. So making links with Ottoman activists, you know, in Turkey, Anatolia, the Hejaz as well. Now, so here we have a very different optic than one that draws history not just from the colonial level. We also have a different optic from that which draws history as the actions of leaders and masses, whether it be like a movement like Gandhianism, which is great at mobilizing, but again, falls victim to that sort of fear after the Charichar incident. Instead, this is a different optic in which the facts of power, and it's a different optic still from that of colonial power, drawing lines, cutting people off from each other, and exerting sort of trauma on a helpless mass. Here, it's not we don't deny the existence of these powerful vertical structures, right? But when you start looking at history from the perspective of the things that devotees wrote and all of these things, and sang about, and you know, these kind of things, then these powerful vertical structures are the things that make life difficult, but they are not the most important thing. I mean, the main thread in these narratives, so far as I can see, is a sort of the horizontal sort of connections, the webbing that one can make in the spaces between all these powerful structures, you know? So, finally, you know, this may seem to preserve yet another sort of location of elites, even if it's sort of below the Congress level. This too is a feature of sort of Urdu historiography about all these movements. So you're not going to read about Abdul Rahim Popoza in English basically at all. You will read about him in Urdu. When you do that, you basically get the sense that this man is bringing both Diobandi reformism and communism to a bunch of semi-literate mountain people who have no grounding in these things. This is incorrect. The more that we read, so similar to what Leyli was talking about. When you start paying attention to these peers who may have had education from elsewhere and have a broadly leftist consciousness from elsewhere, when they start interacting with locals and they enter into these relationships where you don't sort of go there to teach, but rather, and you don't go there to listen, rather you make the sort of life worlds of the people who you're interacting with and their emotional landscapes and all of these things part of your practice, part of your own personality and part of your practice too. So when I was trying to untangle the threads of like, you know, it strikes me, people like Maulana Pashani, as much as people like Maulana Popoza or the Ajisip of Ferenze, they, if they were leftist in any way, in what we might broadly call it that, and I like that quote by Pashani, you know, it's like, well, you might call me that, but this is a prior thing. It's exactly the case. So when we start looking at the places that I'm looking at and the way that this interaction happens between elites and whatever, everyday people, you see that actually a large, substantial portion of the things that these elites were saying are drawn from not just in content, but even in form, the sorts of media that locals expressed and mediated their own emotional worlds through. So in other words, you get the beer, Fazlul Mahmud Makhfi using the same oral poetry that the people that he encountered did. And furthermore, even the same sort of imagery and emotional vocabularies and all these things. If we can trace a basis for the mutuality that characterized things like the Magar movement later on, I mean, I would posit that it comes from these experiences of mountain Sufism exerting their effect on leaders rather than the opposite. What's my takeaway here as I conclude this paper? Well, there's 2 points. One of them simple. The simple one is just reiterating the point of multiplicity and openness to other experiences hidden in the many stories that we tell about freedom and who, you know, where is freedom located? Where does freedom come from? What is it in the first place? These are not, you know, universal categories. And if we want to sort of get at these things, then multiplicity helps us a great deal. The other slightly more complicated point that I wanted to make is that appropriation and hierarchies, they exist both in real life, in the actual histories that I'm talking about, like the positive history, as well as in the stories that we tell about them too. So not only is this act of like co-opting mass agency and bringing it into a paramilitary organization an act of real life sort of corralling and channelizing and hierarchizing, but actually the way that we create our historical stories does the same thing, right? So like if we tell a story that tells the story of, you know, the this particularly top-down type of pedagogy in contrast to the one that Leyli talked about, or the kind of story where you just cut people off from each other with the stroke of a pen, and they're helpless to do anything about it. And, you know, these are acts of hierarchizing information and people's experiences as well. That's important because stories are the raw materials with which we imagine life and the life that we're in, and on the basis of which we act to produce new life, you know, new kinds of living, new ways of relating to each other. This act of reimagining worlds in which all are open, in the way that my frontier activists were, to the influence of radically different ways of seeing and living in the world. This is vital to activism, as we can see. It's also vital to scholarship as well. In fact, I'd go so far as to say if you do them right, then both are part of the same thing. So I'm going to end with that. It's a sentiment that I hope resonates with the spirit of the event as well as the man it memorializes, as in addition to the other two speakers who came before me tonight. So, yes, thanks. I'll hand it over to Farouk for another.
Thank you, Afru. The house is open now for questions. Needless to remind, please be very brief. Okay, we begin there.
I've got a question which is primarily for Professor Ahmed, but it picks up on where Khaled has just left off in terms of this question of new ways of thinking about activism and the sort of channeling of mass activism into paramilitary structures. And Dr. Professor Ahmed, you talked about a sort of organizational structure of partition, which I have to say was quite new to me in terms of collaboration between politicians, gangs, the lower strata of administration. And while Khaled was talking about that in terms of a positive liberation activism, you're talking about it in terms of a ethnic cleansing, a sort of paramilitary ethnic cleansing. Could you just sort of briefly talk to it and perhaps point us in the direction of where we can find out more about that idea? The organization, because it seems to echo the 1984 pogrom in Delhi, for example.
Let us take 2 more questions and then we can begin. Yes?
You speak louder, please.
Yeah, okay. You carry some part of the legacy of that thing in a way that you are equally admired across the border. I know you have a lot of fans in India and in Pakistan, and you have recently come from Lahore. we need an appetite for peace in the whole region. What is your assessment? And how is it shaping up?
One question there.
Does the panel think that it is time to replace the brown sahabs like we did the white sahabs one day? Why I'm saying that is because given that we have a Indian and Pakistani students at the SOAS, all struggles of freedom started from here. Also, in terms of now, we have a big Pakistani, Bangladeshi, and Indian trade union and a revolutionary movement here, right? And also, in terms of the Indian left, you start to think of Lal Salam rather than Vande Mataram. Paminder, if Bhagat Singh is to ate honda, kenda maye ni maye, eh azadi, mani chanda sega, jodi aj, manu, sanu, azadi, azadi, neche di sigi. Inkalab, zinda
ma. Okay, yes. Let's begin with these questions. Actually, two of the questions were initially, Ishtiaq.
Correctly, I mean, the comparison you were making or the connection. I think he's referring to a movement in which these, you know, connections are important to build solidarity. I'm talking of a situation where I didn't have the time actually to present my theoretical framework, which begins by questioning Hobbes' theory of the intrinsic evil nature of man. And I tried to see that if the state collapses, you know, this is his great, great threat, that if there is no state, society will revert to its animal sort of aggression. And I wanted to look at the partition of Punjab through that prism. But I discovered that to assume that there is a fixed human nature is wrong. It all depends on the circumstances. And even in the worst of circumstances, I have a lot of evidence of people going out of the way to help total strangers, to risk their own lives for them. And so one can't really reduce human nature to any one particular fixed type of thing. But when the state is disintegrating, who all can come in and exploit it the best? And that would be the criminal gangs who have always been there, would be the politicians whose morals are very low, and that was very true of the politicians of the Punjab as we know. The police is always very corrupt. And so these nexuses actually preyed on innocent people as they tried to escape from one place to another. And the point I make in this sort of investigation is, and I had 400 interviews done. This book took me 12 years to complete, of which 232 interviews are quoted, in some cases with pictures of people who confessed that they killed people of the opposite community. Okay? And there are some cases where I traced people from the same village or to the same locality after 60 years and looked at their versions of the same incidents. So all that is there. But basically what emerges is that it was not ordinary Hindus, Muslims and Sikhs who would attack their neighbors or just, strangers. It had to be someone goading them on to do that. And this was very often the police, the magistrate, and the politicians at the top, telling them that if you do it, I'll protect you ultimately. And there's a lot of evidence of the sort. So his case is very different from mine. That's my answer to your question. And so yours. Well, you're very kind and very generous. My popularity actually comes from this common wisdom that India and Pakistan at the moment are in a position to destroy this region forever. And for me, believing in peace is not really much of an option. I think it's the only sane thing anyone who's educated and informed would naturally come to. The thing is that in both India and Pakistan, the national narrative is so one-sided. let me give an example from a pleasant example, not a bad one. On the 4th of March, 2013. Now that's exactly the day on which riots broke out in Amritsar. Okay? So that is the day when I spoke at the Guru Nanak Dev University. As it were, they said you have to speak in English. So I delivered my talk in English. And then later on, I mixed with the students. And then naturally, we started talking in Punjabi. And I noticed that the students were just looking at me, bewildered a little. And then one girl, mastered the courage to say, "Sir, tusi te badi soni Punjabi bolde." Now, you know, that was an eye-opener for me. They didn't realize that just across the border, and you know, the distance between Amritsar and Lahore is only 54 kilometers, some say 49. That is where 85 million of the Punjabis live, and they speak Punjabi from morning to evening. So the partition has, on both sides, really drawn the curtain, and so you don't know the other fellow. But I've lived abroad and met fascinating people like Amrit Preetam. I've met Hindus who have gone out of the way to help me. My mother was down with cancer. And the record is that some of her our Hindu neighbors were more devoted to her than perhaps her own sons. So I refuse to accept that the people of this region are particularly comes very naturally. I have no other choice.
Okay, we have another round of questions now. First there, and then there. These were the first two hands raised. I will come to everyone. Wait. And then Shahjahan, then there will be a third round. We have enough time to go for coffee.
Sorry, sir. Panel, what happened to my question?
It was not really a question, it was a comment, and I wonder if anybody wants to comment on his comment.
Okay. I think I'll add to the comment made by our brother here, that they said that you reap what you sow. What was sown in India and would led the partition was the establishment of the rule of a particular classes of landlords and capitalists, development of capitalism both in India and Pakistan, and the vision of Bhagat Singh was the other way around, to bring a system with a vision where it's a rule of the working class in alliance with the peasantry. And the very fact we're holding a meeting of Bhagat Singh today, and we are brought here in this meeting from both India, Pakistan, and Bangladesh, is a real big credit to the organizers. And it is that vision, it is a fulfillment of that dream, not the freedom of dreams, which is today, but to the vision of our martyrs, Bhagat Singh, Uddin Singh, Kartar Singh Sarabha, that is going to shape the destiny and change, for both, bring change both for the people of Pakistan, India, and also of Bangladesh.
Okay, thanks. Thanks for the comment. Yes, please.
So I'm Pranav, I study history at LSE, and I do an intercollegiate module here at SOAS. Just with Professor Ahmed, a lot of what I'm doing with my dissertation is along those kind of lines. So I'm Punjabi, and basically, growing up, I never really sort of sensed any kind of difference whether someone is Hindu or Muslim, like amongst Punjabis. But then towards my teenage years, I started to notice there was these kind of subtle differences, despite the fact that there is a lot of shared culture. And then increasingly, I became more attuned to that as I became an undergraduate student. And now in my final year, I'm doing my dissertation looking at the origins of this communalism, which has been exported perhaps more intensely in the diaspora than it is actually back in Punjab.
Gentlemen, your question.
So my question is to do with whether the revival of an open acknowledgement of the regional shared culture that historians like Farina Mir, Roger Ballard has also talked about as well, whether that might be, and the same on the Bengali side, the revival of this kind of regional shared culture that cuts across religious divisions, that might be the way that can pave, you know, for a brighter future that we've just been discussing here, not just for those regions, but for the subcontinent as a whole.
Thank you. Shahjahan,
thank you very much. My name is Shahjahan Baluch, and I just would like to share that for Bhagat Singh, we have a lot of respect and inspiration in Balochistan. As you know, that there is a moment of resistance and freedom there. And my question is that, because the National Army Party played a very important role in reorganizing the nationalists, do you see any possibility of solidarity between Baloch and Pashtun, because they are suffering, like, because of the British divide, Balochistan is suffering in three, like there is a Balochistan in Iran, Afghanistan, and Pakistan, and the same is with the Pashtun. So what kind of possibilities you're looking in future for any solidarity between Baloch and Pashtun, or any possibility of party like National Army Party in future?
Let's take one more question, because there was one comment, then we come back to the speakers.
Talking about partition, I want to say that the British never recognized nations and nationalities in India. So they only recognized there are only two nations in India. One is a Muslim nation, other is Hindu nation. They didn't recognize, well, somebody Punjabi or Kashmiri or Malayali or whatever. That is the main reason that Congress or neither Muslim League, they actually accepted this division by the British. And that is the main cause of division in India. And other thing, the British at that time, they wanted to keep, as you said as well, Russia, you said that they wanted to have use of port of Karachi as well as the manpower, military manpower. And also, they wanted to block Russia at that time, because they saw Russia as a threat, because Russia already had some connection with Turkey and other areas, and they wanted, through Pakistan, access, because they wanted use of oil. That's why they divided India. And that is a legacy of the British colonialism, that people are still fighting on the basis of religion in Pakistan as well as in India. So to oppose that legacy, we have to change the systems there.
Do you have a question, please?
Question is that, do you think that there is a need for changing the system there, so that the sovereignty is in the hands of people rather than the big capitalists? No.
Okay. So there is a question for Ishtiaq Ahmed, one for James, and perhaps Leyli can also speak about it. And a couple of comments if anybody wants to add to these comments. So over to James first.
Okay. As for the question of what I think about Pakhtun and Baloch solidarity, I mean, this is not a question that I should answer. You know, I'm neither Pakhtun nor Baloch, and this is not an issue. Now, what I can talk about is actually directed to the previous question about solidarity in general. I can certainly talk about that abstractly and then bring it to what I actually should talk about. So, what I think is, you know, with regard to a shared regional culture as the basis for some kind of solidarity in opposition to, like, religious community or whatever, yes, maybe, that might work. This doesn't work in a lot of cases, though, and we need stronger tools than that. In fact, like, looking at the things that, for example, Maulana Kashani and some of the activists that I talked about did, a lot of this involved, like, embracing radical difference and making it a part of yourself. People who are quite different from you, who you don't share culture with, who don't see the world in the same way as you do, and don't live the same way that you do. And yet, having the sort of empathy that allows you to inhabit that perspective, if only incompletely and briefly, and make that a part of your personality. Care about the things that other people care about. Now, this seems like quite idealistic thing to say. But, I mean, I've been recently reading articles that about eco-socialism as well. And so, when you're making links with other people who are radically different from you, and making this a cornerstone of your practice, and sort of incorporating just an interest. Yeah, so some of my authors say the things that we, our crisis is not that of capital or these kind of things when it comes to the destruction of the entire world. It's a sort of separation of yourself from the earth as part of the entire connectedness of it all. Now, embracing things that are radically different from you, if they don't stop at other people, but also start embracing non-human forms of life. This is actually possibly one of the only ways forward to link the activism of previous eras into the kind of movement. This also gets at the question of solidarity across ethnic lines and other things. Now, you want to put that into practice. I mean, there are very strong historical reasons why there's not Bakun-Baloch solidarity at the moment. These have to do with the kinds of bordering that we could talk about all night long. By making people coexist in a particular space under terms that wouldn't be theirs otherwise.
Yeah. Thanks a lot. Leyli, do you have any?
I mean, I think I pretty much share James's sentiment about in terms of, you know, how do we think about solidarity and how do we think beyond the idea of just culture, shared regional culture, is actually trying to think. I mean, this is where I was explicating sort of Maulana Bashani's pedagogy, which is really the idea of embracing radical difference, but also thinking about other forms of practices that we can include again in the sense of reflecting, listening, to act on those sort of other forms of solidarity, right? That this idea of solidarity between Pashto and Baloch and Bengal was not, it's not entirely radical, a radical thought itself. It was there in 1957 when the National Warming Party was created, and we have to sort of, so what we have to do is retrace historical grounds and retrace the politics of that period just to see on what grounds was solidarity possible. And I think it, what you'll find is that there's a certain, I mean, and that is of, I mean, it's on the basis of class, right? There's a certain with the National Army Party, it's really on the idea of class. There's an idea of land reform, sort of land distribution, and so on, sort of solidarities amongst. So we have to, I mean, I think there has to be certain ways of thinking about what other solidarities are there beyond shared regional cultures that we can draw together, and what other, and sort of the practices that we can in sort of negating some of the differences between, so one of that of listening, I think that sort of practice of listening has itself died out in some ways, so, yeah.
First of all, your comment. Mm-hmm. You know, for years I've been, my friends would testify to that, been saying, this is a slogan I use, culture unites and politics divides. One can even say culture unites and religion divides. Religion, when it becomes politics, it's an ideology. So that's it. And actually, the cultural links of the people, well, nationality-wise, among Punjabis, among Sindhis, and then as you move towards the Gangetic plains, you would find that among the common people, there is a lot of sense of helping out each other. But remember, the people at the top are experts in creating all the differences and so on. So, while agreeing with you, I don't know what more to say. But it's obvious that it's so many centuries and millenniums and layers of cultural links, which if we can bring them back, they can help us a lot. And about you, sir, I would say that you are very right. For the British, it was very clear that they wanted to retain India as long as they could. So when Congress was created, the hope was that this would provide a cushion between some sort of terrorist activities which were going on at that time, after 1857, and a negotiation with the highly educated Indians and so on and so forth. Then comes Gandhi and radicalizes the Congress. And then comes the Ghadar Party and Bhagat Singh, and they have their own form of radicalization, more militant. So I would say that from the British point of view, it was good to have Gandhi and the Congress represent Indian opinion. Until Gandhi pushed them against the wall, and then they started cultivating Jinnah. So for the British, the whole strategy was to hold on to India as long as they could. Finally, as you rightly point out, the reason I didn't complete my statement, it's if you read my two books, this the partition one on the Punjab and Pakistan, the garrison state, which has been in discussion a lot in Pakistan these days. I have given the original documents where Sir Francis Tucker, head of the Eastern Command, there were four commands during the British period. Eastern Command, Calcutta; Southern Command, Madras; Northern Command, Rawalpindi; and Central Command, Delhi. So Sir Francis Tucker says that we need to create a Muslim state in Northern India connecting from Algeria to Arabia Desertia into Turkey and Persia into Northern India as a bulwark to stop the expansion of Soviet communism. It's very clearly stated. And then on the 12th of May 1947, the three heads of the British Armed Forces, the head of the Air Force, the head of the Navy, the head of the Army, the hero of the Second World War, Field Marshal Montgomery, and three people from the Colonial Office, write a memorandum, which I presented earlier in a short form, saying that we need Pakistan now because we Hindustan may go its own way, but Jinnah is willing to join the Commonwealth and provide us the services we need. Obviously, they didn't trust Congress. They didn't trust Nehru. Nehru was not all that bad. He had a very strong affiliation with the left, and his liking for the Soviet 5 years plans and so on was very well known. But Mr. Jinnah was somebody they thought they could do business. And the truth is, how did they conduct the Afghan Jihad? Through Pakistan. So the investment of the British was cast upon by the Americans. And that's fantastic for the British farsightedness, strategic thinking. Had India been united with a sort of radical government, I don't think this service could have been possible. But with a divided India and a Pakistan weaker than India, always in need of external help, it fell into the trap of the colonial geostrategic thinking. So I totally agree with you.
Okay, this will be the last round of questions, and please only questions, no comments. Our speakers will be here during the coffee break, even afterwards. You will get the time to speak to them informally. I will begin with Mujahid Saab there, then our lady guest there. But let's begin with Mujahid.
Good to see you. I haven't seen you since mid-80s. I've been reading a lot of his prehistoric things like Indus Valley and these people really did not resort to conflict resolution through violence. Why? We cannot really go back and then really just sit out. I worked in Kabul with 20-year-old meter readers, and they would tell me, look, Peshawar is ours. We'll just go back there one day. So all of these, things that have been churned up, why can't we as, historically in, Mohenjo-Daro was done that without killing and why can't we resolve these things? I mean, 70 years of, you know, this kind of really bickering and horror.
Sir, I will just tell you, read Sahir's poem, Sharif Insano. It's on the 65th wall. He speaks for all. Sharif Insano.
There. Excuse me. Let's have the questions first.
Okay, I'm trying to frame it into a question, which I think is quite important. James, I'm really sorry, it's very hot up here, so by the time you were speaking, the focus was going a bit. No disrespect to you, but I do think, in terms of moving on, and I'm talking about conflict and partition, and equally in terms of Bangladesh and the war there, but as the daughter and granddaughter of refugees, and I that personally found well into my 40s, the refugee identity and owning that has been quite strategic in exploring. The one of the key things that's never addressed around this legacy of partition is the fear that was created simply just by the fact that you're going to lose your ancestral lands, your livelihood, and whatever. So that projection went out to your Muslim or Hindu or whatever enemies. And so people went one day from living in unity to then being told, we're going to lose everything, literally lose everything, both physically and, of course, in terms of family and women, certainly. And I think that climate of fear that was then obviously played upon, as you said, and I know from testimonies, not in my family, but just my family, but reminiscence, that that's very important. So what we've collectively inherited, being from that area, that South Asian band, I call, which is a pun that I now use, which is called, you know, sub, is both individual wounds and collective wounds. And really the questions are, how do we move on from ownership of those individual wounds and collective and a collective wound? And some of it, I think, is in the conceptuality of being caught between India, Pakistan, and this notion of two nation states, and whatever has gone on with Bangladesh as well, you know. And I'm kind of raising that. I don't know if the panel can go, but I think we have to really look at ways of looking at what was very orchestrated, I think, you know. My mum said, not my father, meaning, you know, when the English play games, I've learned of things as early as 1921, even after the First World War, you know. Just look at what happened in Iraq and Iran. That was orchestrated years before. In our lifetimes, we've seen things that had oil agendas, you know. So we kind of have to almost create new kind of dimensions and conceptualities, I think, in order to move ahead. It is about cultural, you know, togetherness and all of that, but actually looking that we were, in true sense, victims of very, very complex machinations, and own those and then move on. And if you have any ideas, do contact me, because we're trying to look at doing events around that.
Thank you very much. There was a question here. Okay, quick ones. Yes. First.
Me?
Yeah.
So I have a question for Dr. Uddin. I was wondering if you could speak a little bit more about power and hierarchies, but also like centering rage and why that was important in Kashmir's organizing. Also as a way of like perhaps disrupting how in this room we're speaking as if we're like neutral characters without, you know, power removed from all of these consequences. So
My question is for Dr. Emma. Like you said that any basically in the current educated population in India and Pakistan, the main practical solution is to live in peace. But any discussion of any strained relations between the two nations starts with like Kashmir nowadays. So I would kind of like you to comment, if possible, briefly, in any position or role, like, you know, contemporary Kashmir has in any efforts that the two nations are making towards peace.
Okay, thank you. Ali?
I have a brief question. I'm adding
Okay. Thanks a lot. There are actually rather three questions to Ishtiaq, then one to Leyla, and perhaps a few comments which James would like to further comment. But this will be the last sort of time we'll be speaking and summing it up. So let's begin with Ishtiaq, then Leyla, and we move on.
Yeah, Professor Ishtiaq, tell me what is the difference. You could throw it in a cutter on a chain. Ali, so the question about Kashmir, okay? Some people say that without its resolution, things will not move forward. This is the Pakistani position. The Indians say that first terrorism should come to an end, and then we can discuss how to resolve Kashmir. Actually, the Kashmir issue, the way I understand, some people will disagree. There is no solution except a win-win-win for the three groups: India, Pakistan, and the Kashmiris. And I stand solidly behind the Kasuri plan, which has been put forward. The BJP government, the Congress government, the Pakistan army, the Kashmiri leaders, with one exception, all have come out in support of it. And it says that for the next 15 years, the line of control will be the actual border. And then during this 15 years, they will try to build, you know, good relations, trade, confidence in one another. And then they will see whether this should become the permanent border or another solution is possible. But the Kashmir solution, the Kashmir issue is ready to be resolved. All we need is the proper environment and climate. Let's hope it happens sooner than later. There was another, there were three questions you counted for me. Which was the second and the third?
It was here by...
Yes. Well, actually, I really don't know how to say this, because the way my friend Pritam was saying that Bhagat Singh wanted socialism. Now, if we were to sit together, we'll discuss whether when Bhagat Singh was thinking this, was it possible to go for socialism directly at that time, given all the imperialist colonial presence, and as he rightly pointed out, that the national bourgeoisie wanted to have capitalism, how would socialism come? So similarly, the question is, the left may, probably they erred. You know, it was a remiss on their part not to mobilize women. But this is true. You know, they have tried and it doesn't work. Although, strangely enough, it was the Khudai Khidmatgar movement where somehow Abdul Ghaffar Khan was able to take up female issues and he supported women's education, for example. So it didn't come from that traditional left or Marxist left, but some organizations of a conventional sort of Pakhtun identity. The left has been remiss about the gender question in a very, very big manner. Have you looked at the Communist Party of China or of the Soviet Union? Did they have any women in the Politburo? The only one I remember is the wife of Deng Xiaoping, and you know, then what happened to her? We know the Gang of Four. So, let's not romanticize Marxism. It was an ideology born of a different age and different challenges, and behind, we can't subsume everything behind capitalism as an evil. Actually, that's not a representation of Marx at all. Mm-hmm. Marx very strongly believed that capitalism was a revolutionary system, and when it comes, it will enter into contradictions, and that will be resolved through socialism. So this jump from a feudal, colonial sort of society into socialism was not Marx's idea. So this is a romantic view of socialism, in my opinion. And what was the third question?
Mujahid
sir. Ajit Mujahid sir? I will give this example. Bulle Shah da ek sher sun lo. Jede bhi sari gal samap ho jati hai. Gal samaj lehi te rola ki. Gal samaj lehi te rola ki. Eh Ram Rahim te maula ki. ਇਸ ਤੇ ਸਾਰੀ ਗੱਲ ਖਤਮ ਹੋ ਜਾਂਦੀ ਹੈ ਜੇ ਤੁਸੀਂ ਇਹ ਮੰਨ ਲਓ ਕਿ ਹਰ ਇਨਸਾਨ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਉਹੀ ਹੈਗਾ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਤੁਹਾਡੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਹੈ ਤੇ ਮੁੱਕ ਜਾਂਦੀ ਹੈ ਸਾਰੀ ਗੱਲ ਕਿਉਂ ਜੀ ਤੇ ਸਾਡੇ ਇਨ ਆਰ ਓਨ ਵਿਜ਼ਡਮ ਦੇ ਇਨ ਆਰ ਓਨ ਹੈਰੀਟੇਜ ਦਿਸ ਵਿਜ਼ਡਮ ਇਜ਼ ਵੈਰੀ ਸਟਰੋਂਗ ਵੀ ਹੈਵ ਟੂ ਰਿਵਾਈਵ ਇਟ ਐਂਡ ਵੀ ਕੀਪ ਟ੍ਰਾਇੰਗ ਇਟ ਆਲ ਦਾ ਟਾਈਮ
ਥੈਂਕ ਯੂ ਵੈਰੀ ਮਚ
I think it's really important that you thank you for the question about power and hierarchies, and I think it's a sort of it's important because we have to think about the sort of histories that get written these days. Who writes these histories? What sort of histories get written? We've come to a talk and we've heard of Marxism, we've heard of capitalism, we've heard of communism, and we've heard of Das Kapital and intellectual, and it's this sort of high politics, right? This is where we lay our interests. This is where the interests have been put forward. But where are the people in the conversation? How do we get, where are their stories in any of what we've said today? And I think that's important in in terms of thinking about the powers and hierarchies, in terms of how we're speaking about history, in terms of who's writing the histories, what sort of archives we're going to, what sort of individuals we're looking to. So the reason why I speak about Maulana Bashani is because he's the man who produces new text, right? He's a man who produces new text, yes. And so the only way of getting to know a guy like Maulana Bashani is actually through his constituencies of peasants and workers. Now, and that's a really important sort of taking sort of a reappropriation of histories that have been sort of a reappropriation of histories. I think we need to think about how we're thinking about Bhagat Singh and how we're thinking about all these other martyrs. Like we're talking about them in terms of these and their intellectualizations in terms of that they've read these great tomes of work. But really, I think that's not where they sort of, I think that their intellectual sort of lives lie. I think their intellectual lives in their ability to relate to or to empathize with a certain group of people which they're different to, right? So I think I'm incoherently answering your question, but I have thought about, I think power hierarchies are important, and I think it's really sort of, I do think about it in terms of very few questions on Bangladesh that I've got today, and I think that's very important. Why are we not speaking about Bangladesh itself? And I think that's because it still rests in the periphery of most people's political imagination. If we are talking about solidarity, why have few questions been directed about Bangladesh towards it? So anyway, nonetheless. So the other thing about sort of thinking about sort of anger is really, I think this has become a tool. I mean, I think anger is a very important tool. It's in the sense that it's been de-radicalized because it has been associated in some ways with violence. And it's a very different sort of political tool. It's the sort of, anger is a sort of an energy. It's a one that invigorates, which one that energizes, and one that increases the appetite. So Bashani realized that with anger as a tool for the working class, because the only way to equalize yourself is by showing the sort of the strength of that community, and that strength is a collective sort of anger at the injustices that are perpetrated on those communities. It's an incoherent answer, it's an inarticulate answer, but I'm sure that,
Thanks a lot. James, you have any comments?
My strong preference is to let Dr. Leyli have the last word on this one.
Okay, thanks a lot, our distinguished panelists.
Some should come to an end, and then we can discuss how to resolve Kashmir. Actually, the Kashmir issue, the way I understand, some people will disagree. There is no solution except a win-win-win for the three groups: India, Pakistan, and the Kashmiris. And I stand solidly behind the Kasuri plan, which has been put forward, the BJP government, the Congress government, the Pakistan army, the Kashmiri leaders with one exception, all have come out in support of it. And it shares that for the next 15 years, the line of control will be the actual border. And then during this 15 years, they will try to build, you know, good relations, trade, confidence in one another. And then they will see whether this should become the permanent border or another solution is possible. But the Kashmir solution, the Kashmir issue is ready to be resolved. All we need is the proper environment and climate. Let's hope it happens sooner than later. There was another, there were three questions you counted for me. Which was the second and the third?
It was here by...
Yes. Well, actually, I really don't know how to say this because the way my friend Pritam was saying that Bhagat Singh wanted socialism. Now, if we were to sit together, we'll discuss whether when Bhagat Singh was thinking this, was it possible to go for socialism directly at that time, given all the imperialist colonial presence, and as he rightly pointed out, that the national bourgeoisie wanted to have capitalism, how would socialism come? So similarly, the question is, the left, probably they erred, you know, it was a remiss on their part not to mobilize women. But this is true, you know, they have tried and it doesn't work. Although, strangely enough, it was the Khudai Khidmatgar movement where somehow Abdul Ghaffar Khan was able to take up female issues and he supported women's education, for example. So it didn't come from that traditional left or Marxist left, but some organizations of a conventional sort of Pakhtun identity. The left has been remiss about the gender question in a very, very big manner. Have you looked at the Communist Party of China or of the Soviet Union? Did they have any women in the Politburo? The only one I remember is the wife of Deng Xiaoping, and you know, then what happened to her, we know, the Gang of Four. So let's not romanticize Marxism. It was an ideology born of a different age and different challenges, and behind, we can't subsume everything behind capitalism as an evil. Actually, that's not a representation of Marx at all. Marx very strongly believed that capitalism was a revolutionary system, and when it comes, it will enter into contradictions, and that will be resolved through socialism. So this jump from a feudal, colonial sort of society into socialism was not Marx's idea. So this is a romantic view of socialism, in my opinion. And what was the third question?
Mujahid sir,
I have said, I will give this example. Bulle Shah da ek sher sun lo. Jede vich sari gal samap ho jandi hai. Gal samajh lai te rola ki. Gal samajh lai te rola ki. Ay Ram Rahim te maula ki. ऐसे सारी गल खत्म हो जाती है जब तुसी यह मान लो कि हर इंसान दे विच ओही हैगा जेड़े तुहाडे च है ते मुक जांदी है सारी गल क्यों जी ते साडे इन आवर ओन विजडम दे इन आवर ओन हेरिटेज दिस विजडम इज वेरी स्ट्रांग वी हैव टू रिवाइव इट एंड वी कीप ट्राइंग इट ऑल द टाइम
थैंक यू वेरी मच
It's important because we have to think about the sort of histories that get written these days. Who writes these histories? What sort of histories get written? We've come to a talk and we've heard of Marxism, we've heard of capitalism, we've heard of communism, and we've heard of Das Kapital and intellectual. And it's this sort of high politics, right? You know, this is where we've laid our interests. This is where the interests have been put forward. But where are the people in the conversation? How do we get, where are their stories in any of what we've said today? And I think that's important in sort of the in terms of thinking about the powers and hierarchies, in terms of how we're speaking about history, in terms of who's writing the histories, what sort of archives we're going to, what sort of individuals we're looking to. So the reason why I speak about Maulana Bashani is because he's the man who produces no text, right? He's a man who produces no text, yes. And so the only way of getting to know a guy like Maulana Bashani is actually through his constituencies of peasants and workers. Now, you know, and that's a really important sort of taking sort of a reappropriation of histories that have been sort of a reappropriation of histories. I think we need to think about how we're thinking about Baba Singh and how we're thinking about all these other martyrs. Like we're talking about them in terms of, you know, these sort of, and their intellectualizations in terms of that they've read these great tomes of work. But really, I think they're, and that's not where the sort of, I think that their intellectual sort of lives lie. I think their intellectual lives in their ability to relate to or to empathize with a certain group of people which they're different to, right? So I think there's I'm incoherently answering your question, but I have thought about, you know, I think hierarchies are important, and I think it's really sort of, you know, I do think about it in terms of the very few questions on Bangladesh that I've got today. And I think that's very important. Why are we not speaking about Bangladesh itself? And I think that's because it still rests in the periphery of most people's political imagination. If we are talking about solidarity, why have few questions been directed about Bangladesh towards it? So anyway, nonetheless. So the other thing about sort of thinking about sort of anger is really, I think this has become a tool. I mean, I think anger is a very important tool. It's in the sense that it's been de-radicalized because it has been associated in some ways with violence. And it's a very different sort of political tool. It's this sort of, anger is a sort of an energy. It's a one that invigorates, which one that energizes, and one that increases the appetite. So Bashani realized that with anger as a tool for the working class, because the only way to equalize yourself is by showing the sort of the strength of that community, and that strength is a collective sort of anger at the injustices that are perpetrated on those communities. It's an incoherent answer, it's an inarticulate answer, but I'm sure that, you know, we can talk about this
on the next one. Thanks a lot. James, you have any comments?
My strong preference is to let Dr. Leyli have the last word on this one.
Okay, thanks a lot, our distinguished panelists.